are we doing today? Ooh, five of you are doing great. I am so excited that you joined us today. And as Justin said, we've been in this series talking about the State of the Union. And being a church that's only 8 weeks old, we're 2 months old today, which is crazy. We thought, what a better way to talk about our core values, what we believe, why do we do what we do? And last week, Justin talked about this core value of risk-taking faith. And as Justin kind of alluded to, we've got to just like a front row seat to the amazing risk takers within the walls of this church and on the outside of God, just bringing in some people like Stephen and Amanda who would risk leaving a very large church for a teeny tiny church plant. And when Justin and I were praying about 2 years ago about what Hope City would look like, we have been amazed at the people that God has brought to us along the way who are willing to live out this core value of just taking risks in the name of God. That oftentimes God isn't looking for our ability, but as Justin said last week, he's looking for our availability. And if you missed last week, we have this awesome thing called the Hope City app, and you can download it on iTunes. And on the app, you can find message notes, you can find old messages, and you can also find the Bible. Like, everybody needs the Word of God. So it's great. So if you don't have your Bibles with you, it's cool. But if you do, I want you to open up to 1 Peter chapter 2. And we're going to camp out in there. Just hold your finger there while we're there. You can just simply read on the screens. But the value that we're talking about today is that everybody is welcome. And what I love about this value is that it's just all-encompassing. It doesn't matter where you are in life, your season, your background, your economic status, the color of your skin. No matter who you are, the church is a place where everybody is welcome. And I don't know about you, but we're entering into Thanksgiving, season holidays, like we have traditions. And one of the traditions our family has is we love to see movies. Anybody go and see movies over the holidays? Like, we're those people. But beyond going to see new movies, we have these traditional movies that we watch every year. And one of these movies, I believe that, man, the main character, he embodies what it means to be a welcoming person. So take a look.
And then I traveled through the seven levels of the candy cane forest, past the sea of swirly, twirly gumdrops. And then I walked through the Lincoln Tunnel.
So where were you for the last 30 years?
The North Pole.
Can you pass the maple syrup, please?
I didn't put it. It's spaghetti.
You know what? I think I have something. Yes.
You like sugar, huh?
Is there sugar in syrup?
Yes.
Then yes! We elves try to stick to the four main food groups. Candy, candy canes, candy corns, and syrup.
So, will you be staying with us then?
You mean I can stay?
Of course you can.
Emily.
How long do you think you'll be with us?
I hadn't really planned it out, but I was thinking like forever.
Emily, can I just speak to you for a minute in the kitchen, please? Are you crazy? He cannot stay here.
Clearly, he has some serious issues. We can't just throw him out in the snow.
Why not? He loves the snow. He's told me 15 times.
Walter, he's your son.
Did you hear that?
You're so weird.
Oh, I love Buddy. I love Buddy. And I think that's what the church should be. I think everybody needs a buddy in their life. And fortunately, I actually have a real-life buddy. Her name is Eve Annunziato. She's been a friend of mine for almost 2 decades. She lives in Nashville. My best friend, Lindsay, is here today. She can attest to our sweet Eve. Eve is like, she has not only the gift of hospitality, But she's super vivacious, so everything is buddy moments. She's like, I'm so glad you're here. Where do you want to eat? What do you want to do? And she authentically means it. It's like real life buddy. And wouldn't it be great if that was the church? That when you walked in, people were just so happy to see you, not in like a cheesy, inauthentic way, but in a, like, I know how much it took for you to be here today. I know you've had a rough week, but we're just glad you're here. You were welcomed here. We're just glad, and we're just expecting to God to do what only he can. And I want to look at this passage found in 1 Peter, and to just unpack the story, Peter is talking to a group of Gentiles. And Jesus has come, he has walked this earth, and he has been crucified, and he's been risen from the grave, and the first church has begun. And so these words that Peter starts to pour over the Gentiles, they're radical. It's one of the most radical welcomes they've ever experienced. And you can follow along on the screens. Verse 9 and 10. It says, but you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim this excellency of him who called you out of darkness and into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Can you envision Buddy saying these words? Like, you are God's chosen people. Like, the excitement. I believe this is the excitement that Peter had. That Peter believed that the church exists for everybody to be welcomed. One of the things that has been embedded in my heart, in my family's heart, over the past 6-7 years, the church that Justin was on staff at, Cross Point Church in Nashville, we had this saying that not only was a core belief to them, but we have adopted and is a core belief here at Hope City is this, that everybody is welcomed because with God, anything is possible. Everybody is welcome because God, with God, anything is possible. It is the heart behind the welcoming, a belief in a God who has the power to do the impossible. The hard part is that if you've gone to church more than a few Sundays, you know and you've experienced both within the church and outside the church this feeling and this struggle of feeling uninvited. I know that I'm guilty of it. When I try to introduce myself to somebody, I ask you like loads of questions, almost like everything but your blood type. I'm like, where do you live? What do you do for a living? What's your relational status? I one time introduced a couple that weren't even dating as married, and they were like, I know, we're like not together, you know, really awkward. But I think what happens is when we walk into the church and we ask those questions of each other, it turns and it feels more like labels. More than ever before, that when we darken the doors of church, we have singles ministry. We have children's ministry. We have certain Bible studies for certain age groups, and we feel like we have to wear our labels. And when we wear our labels, what happens is that the church becomes a place that we would rather just wear the veneer of who we think people want us to be than actually living out who we really are. That we fear the thought of being fully known but not fully loved. And so we take our labels and we know and we believe that people see us as we step into the doors as single mom, divorced, addict, not enough, right? In this place of church where Peter is saying is supposed to be a place where we find this new identity becomes a place where we hide behind our labels. And Peter knows this. And so as he's speaking into the lives of this brand new church, he begins chapter 2 with these words, verse 1 and 2. He said, so get rid of all evil behavior. Be done with all deceit, hypocrisy, jealousy, and all unkind speech. Like a newborn babies, you must crave pure spiritual milk, so that you will grow into a full experience of salvation. Cry out for his nourishment now that you have tasted the Lord's kindness. I love how the message says, verse 1 and 2, it says, so clean house. So clean your house. Clean house. Make a clean sweep of malice and pretense and envy and hurtful talk. Like Peter knew, like this is going to be a struggle for us when we walk into community with one another to not hold on to our labels. But he's saying, if you want to experience the full salvation of God, not just salvation that gets you into heaven, but salvation that says, man, God has a life for you here on earth beyond your labels. That if we want to have the fullness of our relationship with God, we have to be willing to clean house. And then he goes on to say in verse 4, As you come to him, a living stone rejected by men, but in the sight of God, chosen and precious. Just stop there for a minute. As you come to him, basically Peter's saying, as Jesus welcomes you in, he is a living stone that's been rejected. That we have a Savior that totally gets it. We have a Savior that knows what it's like to leave heaven and walk this earth in community. Community with friends, with his disciples that experienced heaven touching earth. And yet they labeled him. They were confused by him. In fact, even each and every one of them, when he needed them the most, rejected him. That we have the Savior that knows what it's like to be rejected, but God calls him chosen and precious. But then it goes on and it says that this chosenness isn't just for Jesus, but that through Jesus it becomes our promise. Look what it says in verse 5. You yourselves, like living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house, to be a priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. It's this invitation to be welcomed in that isn't dependent on not struggling, but rather finding freedom to see yourself as God sees you. And I imagine that those in the congregation of that first church had a hard time believing that these words like priesthood, those were words for the Jewish culture. In fact, priesthood, that was revered for the actual priest. They were the ones who got to meet with the Lord. And now Peter is saying, no, Jesus has changed everything. The welcome has changed that now we are all his chosen people. But the hard part is if we believe that the church is a place where everybody is welcome, right? Because with God, anything is possible. Then we have to have this reality check. To realize that when we walk in the doors, we bring in baggage. It's just the truth of all of us. For some of us, we are great at faking it till you make it, right? You're the person that everybody wants to be because you're always happy and you always love your job and you always love your kids. And then most of us with kids, we're like, wow, really? There's sometimes I don't like them, you know? Like, there's those moments. But everybody wants to be you because life is so good for you. And so you put on your veneer here, and then you leave this place knowing that your life is a hot mess. For some of you, you bring in your tiredness, and you're just tired. You're tired of being in the drama of life. You're like, if one more thing breaks at work, I'm done, right? If one more family member has an issue, I'm done. And maybe for some of you, you're like me, something that in my honesty of the label that I have been wrestling with is really this idea of bitterness. And there's been situations over the past couple of weeks that has made me even wrestle with this message to come in here and go, okay, Lord, how do you want me to talk about bitterness when I'm wrestling with it myself? Because here's the deal, if you've dealt with bitterness, you believe the lie that I often believe, that bitterness feels safe, right? Bitterness, that you would rather be in the self-protection of bitterness and isolation that bitterness brings us to rather than be in messy community. Because you've tried and you've been disappointed. And there's some of you, you come in here and you're just hopeful. You're like, you know that life's a hot mess, and you just kind of like, I'm done. I just show up, and I'm like, God, you have to show up because there's really, I got nothing else left. That we come to Jesus when we're at the end of ourselves. And what Peter is saying is that the church is a place where everybody is welcomed because we believe this truth that with God, anything is possible. So he says, if we want to live out the fullness of our relationship with God, we have to remember who we are. And I don't know about you, but like if you think about your label, if you think about things that you struggle with, what would you put on your label? What do you feel like defines you? What do you feel like that when you see people, you're just like, I'm bitter. Like, please don't talk to me, especially you. I can't do it right now. I'm just bitter, right? Like, maybe for you, you feel unwanted. You don't feel chosen. You feel invisible. You don't feel seen. And what Peter is saying is he is speaking a new vision of welcome. And he says, but you are the chosen by God. You can read on the screens. You are the chosen ones by God, chosen for a high calling of priestly work, chosen to be a holy people, God's instrument to do his work and speak out for him, to tell others of the night and day difference he has made for you, from nothing to something. from rejected to accepted. It's like Peter saying, listen, I know the labels that you have put on yourself, but God says you are accepted. Wear it, own it. You are accepted in God's eyes. He says he has brought you out of darkness and into the light. That as you wrestle, it is he who pulls us close to him and says, you don't need those labels. I have covered you with my grace and mercy. Will you step into the light? We go from nothing to something. How about that? How many of us wrestle that we feel like we haven't been seen and God says, no. When you see nothing, I see something. And lastly, and I think the most powerful for most of us, is that when we wrestle with our labels, that he calls us chosen. And he says that I choose you. What if the church became a safe place to wrestle? Because here's the deal, if everyone is welcome, because with God anything is possible, the pathway to possibility is found in brokenness. The pathway to possibility is found in brokenness. And this whole thing of brokenness is hard to understand. You see, brokenness is where faith takes action. It's not that life isn't hard, right? It's not like that wounds don't happen. But when we lean into brokenness, when we surrender the darkness into the light, what we're saying is we're going to remember when times get hard that we have tasted and seen the Lord's kindness. That when things get hard, that we come into this place and we allow ourselves to wrestle, to know that in the wrestling, brokenness begins. And as we wrestle, we allow God to take our confession, allow what was in the dark to be brought into the light. And my dear friend, Ann Voskamp, she came out with a brand new book a couple weeks ago. I just saw yesterday, it's like on the New York Times bestseller, which I'm not surprised. But Anne wrote this whole book on the broken way, this concept of brokenness. And I'll be honest with you, it's been a long time since I've read a book where I literally have dog-eared every other page and underlined it. And it's just wrecked me. And I wish I could stand before you and be like, man, I found such healing and like I'm good now, but I'm still in the pit. Like I'm still wrestling through this idea of brokenness. And Anne shares the story about being in church and taking communion like she does every week. And this time, there's a wrestling going on where she's just kind of like challenging God, like, why? Why this brokenness? Why does it have to be this hard? And I want to read an excerpt out of her book, and you can follow along. She says this, the real Jesus turns to our question of why. Why this brokenness? Why this darkness? And says, you're asking the wrong question. You are looking for someone to blame, and there's no such thing as cause and effect here. This happened so the power of God could be seen in him. So imagine her holding the bread and the cup, and God saying that through our brokenness, God is given glory. She goes on to say that there's brokenness that's not about blame. There's brokenness that makes a canvas for God's light. There's brokenness that makes windows straight into our souls. And here's the key. Brokenness happens in a soul, so the power of God can happen in a soul. Read that again. Brokenness happens in a soul so that the power of God can happen in a soul. This is the surrender. This is the darkness being filled with light. And maybe today the invitation you need is this the invitation of validation? To know that it's okay not to be okay. And to realize the leadership at this church truly believes it. That we create a space where it's okay to be messy. It's okay to wrestle with our brokenness. Because I believe if the church is a place where everyone is welcome, then we have to be willing to walk in the darkness with each other to see how God brings us into the light. And I'll be honest, I know what it means to struggle. I know what it means to struggle. I've had more broken relationships than I have fingers and toes, right? After 20 years of ministry, I've walked with a lot of people in their brokenness. And what happens is when we walk with people, especially when it's our brokenness, our darkness, if you're anything like me, what I end up doing is I end up placing Messiah-like expectations on my family and friends. Where I don't feel close to God and I can tangibly see them, I have expectations that somehow they'll fix me. If somehow if I can just be better at work, if somehow if I could just be a better mom, if somehow if I can get the attention of my husband, if I can be not just a friend but a number one friend, then it'll heal the brokenness in my life. And when we place Messiah-sized expectations on one another, we'll always be disappointed. And as a pastor, I have to do a heart check all the time because I love me some people. Like, if you get to know me, I'm one of the most loyalist people you will meet, and it gets me in trouble. I have been a loyal Cubs fan for a long, long time. And a couple years ago when that poor man, I will not speak his name, but that poor man who caught that ball and took us out of our opportunity, I was done with the Cubs. Like, I could not watch anymore. I had convinced myself that there was something, it was me. I watched it, and they lost. And so when I saw that the Cubbies were doing well, Justin's like, my husband's like, you want to watch? I'm like, I think so. And I was kind of like, you know, okay, no, okay. And I was standing, and I was pacing. And then it came to the championship game. I about lost my mind. You know, I'm still recovering from those games. I'm so emotionally tired. And I thought, I mean, I've never been a part of a game where it has been more crazy. I'm like, we're winning this. I'm like, oh my gosh, come on. We're winning. We're losing. I mean, Justin's like, I can't handle you. Like, I can't handle you. But here's the deal. I love the Cubs. I am loyal to the Cubs. But there was nothing that I could do to own that game for them. The only thing I could do was be their number one cheerleader. And I have to wonder, what if we became a place where we cheered each other on? What if the church became a place where we became safe to be messy? And I'll be honest, I think church culture, we've seen it with dear friends of ours, we've seen it in the greater community of church, that we wrestle with this whole idea of leadership failing. And I think culturally the shift that has happened in the church is that the church has become a place of a veneer, a place where we just become who we think people want to become, not only as the congregation, but as leaders. And so out of it, instead of wrestling with our sin, we hide from it. And anytime anyone hides from their sin, the Bible says that sin leads to death. Death of relationships, death of dreams. And Justin and I have been there. That if we want to live life in the fullness where everybody's welcome, because with God anything is possible, then we have to believe it for one another and we have to believe it for our leadership. Because here's I think, a define the relationship moment that we need in the Big C Church. That there's a difference between struggling with our sin and living in our sin. And living in our sin says, you know what? I don't care. I'm going to stay hidden. I don't trust you. I don't want to be accountable to anybody. And out of that sin, the darkness grows. And out of the sin, we start to see less of the light. But to wrestle with our sin, to wrestle and struggle with our brokenness is to say, you know what? A lot like where I'm at right now, I'm having super huge trust issues. And the only way that I am finding healing is to go before God and say, Lord, I'm remembering, I'm leaning into this discipline to lay down this label of distrust, trusting that you'll do what only you can. What if Hope City became a place where we allowed everybody to wrestle? And honestly, to come even if they're living in sin. That if we believe that anything is possible, that everybody is welcome through the possibility of Jesus Christ, we need to become a church where we welcome the mess. So I want to invite the band to come up, and as they do, you'll find on your seat a piece of cardboard. And I just want to challenge you to think through, what label do you find yourself wrestling with? What label has become a barrier from you coming into a relationship, a full relationship of experiencing life to its fullest here in this present day? What has become a barrier in your relationship to find community within the church where it can feel safe, where it can be messy, and trust that God is not done for you, with you, that he has called you to strip down your labels and to clothe yourself, that you are chosen and a redeemed people.
shock you. Our shame doesn't shame you at all.
Your heart this morning? What's your battle that you face that you need to declare that God is bigger than that battle, that there's hope for you, that you have a future? Let's declare this out, this truth, this next lyric that comes up. And you may need to let it pass by the first time to learn it, but we're going to sing it a couple times so we can really sing it out that God is bigger than our battles.
That little card that I had you pick up, I want to take a moment and just right now, would you just close your eyes? Just close your eyes and allow this to be a moment between you and God. And maybe you're holding on to it and you just feel like, I don't know. I don't know what the barrier is. What if we allowed the mess to begin today and just trust God with it? So let's just close our eyes. Heads bowed. I just want to give a moment to some of you in this room where you want so desperately to have that label of chosen. You want that label of redeemed, but you've never accepted the invitation. What if today, maybe for the first time, maybe for the 20th time, but if we believe that everyone is welcome, that God is a God of second chances, maybe today is your second, first, fourth, hundredth chance. Say, Jesus, I choose you. And if that is you this morning, would you be brave enough to raise your hand and say, today I declare a new name. Today I declare that I am loved and chosen by Jesus. If that is you this morning, would you raise your hand? Jesus. You can put your hands down. Let's just all collectively pray together. If you raised your hand, you can say these words out loud, or you can just say them in your head and heart. But Jesus, we are so grateful today, all of us, every one of us, those of us who have been walking for a long time with you, and those who today say, today is my day for a new name, that we believe that you came to this earth as a helpless baby, that you grew into a man, fully God, fully human, that you knew what it was like to struggle, to be rejected, to be looked past, to be made fun of, to be misunderstood. But you chose a death on the cross, a death on a cross that says that you took on our sins while we were still sinners. You died for us. You died for us to find forgiveness and grace that leads to a life of salvation that is lavished in freedom, where we know that even in our mess can never negate the truth of who you are in our lives. And so, Jesus, we pray for all of us that we would lay down our labels and we take on our name, a rightful name, that we are chosen sons and daughters of the King. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.